ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यास ततो जयमुदीरये। नस्तप्रयेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवतं सेवया। भगवते उत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भावति नैस्तिके। रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 9 चैप्टर 5 टेक्स्ट 7 चैप्टर एंड टाइटल दुर्वास मुनिस लाइफ स्पैन। त्वा तेजसा धर्ममयेन संमृतम् तमा प्रकाशश्च दृशो महात्मनाम् दुराध्यायस्ते महिमा गिरं पते। त्वा रूपमेतत् सदसत् परावरम् त्वा तेजसा बाय योर एफ्यूजन्स धर्ममयेन विच इज फुल ऑफ रिलीजियस प्रिंसिपल्स समृतम डिसिपेटेड तमा डार्कनेस प्रकाश च इल्यूमिनेशन ऑल्सो दृशा of all direction mahatmanam of great learned personalities duradhyaya insomramantable te yo mahima glories giram pate o master of speech tvarupam your manifestation Itat, this, asat, sat asat, manifested and unmanifested. Para avaram, superior and inferior. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation, O Master of Speech, by your effulgence full of religious principles, the darkness of the world is dissipated and the knowledge of learned person or great soul is manifested. Indeed, no one can surpass your effulgence, for all things manifested and unmanifested, gross and subtle, superior and inferior, are but various forms of you that are manifested by your effulgence. Purport. Without illumination, nothing can be seen, especially in this material world. The illumination in this world emanates from the effulgence of Sudarshana, the original vision of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The illuminating principles of the sun, the moon, and fire emanate from Sudarshana. Similarly, illumination by knowledge also comes from Sudarshan, because with the illumination of Sudarshana, one can distinguish one thing from another, the superior from the inferior. Generally, people accept a powerful yogi like Durvasa Muni as wonderfully superior. But if such a person is chased by the Sudarshana Chakra, we can see his real identity and understand how inferior he is because of dealings with devotees. Om Magyanat Marandasya Jnana Nanjana Salakaya Chaksoran Mulitam Yena Tasmai Sri Guruve Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Radati Swapadantikam Vandeham Sri Gurun Sri Yuta Pada Kamalam Sri Gurun Vaishnavam Cha Sri Rupam Sangrajatam Sahagano Raghunathan Vitam Tam Sajitam Sarvaitam Savadotam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Visakan Vidam Sham E Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopisa Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostude Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneswari Vrishabhanu Sude Devi Pranamami Aripriye Vanchakalpatrubhyascha Kripasindubhya Evecha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadharo Sri Vasari Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Tvateja Dharma Mayena Samritam Tama Prakasascha Driso Mahatmanam Duradhyayaste Mahima Girampate Tvadrupam Etat Sadasat Paravaram. O Master of Speech, by your effulgence full of religious principles, the darkness of the world is dissipated and the knowledge of learned persons or great souls is manifested. Indeed, no one can surpass your effulgence, for all things manifested and unmanifested, gross and subtle, superior and inferior, are but various forms of view that are manifested by your effulgence. So here, we are continuing the wonderful subject matter of the Ambarish Maharaj, how to be a very wonderful devotee of the Lord has been explained and has been exhibited here by Ambarish Maharaj in the chapter 9, the canto 9, chapter 4, text 18 to verse 20. So beautifully it has been narrated how Ambarish have submitted all his senses in the only service for the pleasure of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Savai mana Krishna padar vidayor vachamsi vaikunta gunanu varnune karau arer mandira marjana disau srutyam chakra yutyate sarkadodhaye Mukunda lingalayo darsana risau tadbhritya gatras prasanga sangamam granam chatatpada saroja saurabe Srimatulasya rasanam tat arpite padau are setra padanu sarpane siro rishikesa padami vandane kamam chadasya kamam suna kamyaya yadatamasloka janasraya rathi. It is a wonderful lesson here for us to learn how to carry out the devotional service for the pleasure of the Lord. And in this way, in any condition of our life, we will be always protected by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Dhruva Muni has been challenging Ambarish Maharaj's path of devotional service. And Ambarish Maharaj is not disturbed by any situation created by Dhruva Muni, because he is totally absorbed only in Krishna consciousness, is nothing else. And Ambarish Maharaj's mind is always absorbed in the thought of Krishna. And somebody is only seeing Krishna, thinking Krishna, and always conscious of Krishna, he doesn't see any danger in the material world. At a time when Prabhupada was in Delhi at one time, at that time there was some problem between Pakistan and India. There was some war was taking place between them. And Prabhupada was sitting with his disciples and he was talking about Krishna Katha with the disciples. And at that moment, one of the reporters have come and he has asked the Swamiji Prabhupada, you all are very much absorbed in the talk of Krishna consciousness and you are not so much worrying about what is happening between Pakistan and India. And Pakistan is throwing the bomb. What do you do when the bomb comes in the midst of your congregational preaching here? And Prabhupada look at that and Prabhupada says, Bhumi apu nalarvayo kammano buddhir evacha ahankara ithiyam me bina prakritir astada. The bomb is nothing else, it's only separated energy of Krishna. So we see Krishna in everything. So we see Krishna is coming. So what is the difficulty in taking Krishna in our life? So in this way, Dhruva Muni, or Ambarish Maharaj, is very much absorbed within his mind in Krishna consciousness. And he uses his legs to go to the temple of the Lord. He uses his hands to do some service, menial service, for cleaning the temple of the Lord. He was using the ear to hear the glorification of the Lord. He's using his two eyes to see the beautiful form of the Lord. And he's using the nostril to smell the fragrance of flowers offered to the Lord. And he's using his mouth to glorify the Lord. And he's using the tongue to taste the prasadam has been offered to the Lord. And he's using his head to bow down in front of the Lord. And he was using the whole body to hug the devotees of the Lord. And totally all his senses he utilizing only into the pleasure of the Lord and nothing else. So this is the success of Krishna consciousness in our life. Anta kale chamamivam smaran muktva kalevaram yaprayati samadbhavam yati natri antra samsaya. At the time of death, if you can think only of Krishna, nothing else in the world. And that is the great success of our life. Yam yam vapi smaran bhavam tajantiyante kalevaram tam tam ivaiti kauntiya sadatat bhava bhavita. But if our consciousness is flickering, is going off from the real subject matter of Krishna consciousness, if you are thinking so many other things other than Krishna and the devotee's blessing, and there is every chance for us in our life to come back again to this material world according to the thought we have at the time of death. That's what Krishna is emphasizing in the chapter 8, text 7, Tasmat Sarvesu Kalesu Ma Manusmaran Yudhyacha May Arpita Mano Buddhir Ma Mivasyasi Asam Sayam. Arjuna, while you are carrying out your duty in this world, with your intelligent and mind always you think of me, and without fail you come back to me. Abhyasa yoga yuktena cetasa nanyaghamina paramam purusam divyam yati parthanuchintayam. If you can absorb in Krishna consciousness without any deviation, and surely you will come back to me, Kavi Puranam, anusasitaram, anur anayam sam anusmaratya, sarvasya nataram achintya rupam aditya varnam tamasasu parastar. If you understand that I am the supreme, the oldest person in the world, and I am also the biggest and the smallest in everything in the world, if you understand that I am the cause of everything in the world, surely you will be absorbed in my consciousness and you'll come back to me. In this way, Krishna consciousness is very simple and very easy, provided that we become conscious of Krishna all the time. And in the chapter 5, text 7 onward, Krishna explains Yoga Yukta Visuddhatma Vijitatma Jitendraya Sarva Bhutatma Bhutatma Kurvan Api Na Lipyate. Those who have controlled their mind and senses, they become very dear to every other living entities in this world. And every living entities in this world, they will be very dear to him. Naiva kinchit karomiti yukto manye tat tatvavit pasyan srivan sparsan jigraham asnan kascham sopan swasan pralapan visrijam jigraham anmisam nimisam hapi indriyane indriyate bios karana nadarayan. A person who is able to, who is trying to control his mind and senses, trying to become the devotee of the Lord sincerely, and for him also he engaged in so many other activities in the material world, none of these activities brings in a very bad reaction in his life. And whether he is seeing, whether he is hearing, whether he is talking, whether he is breathing, whether he is sleeping, whether he is evacuating, whether he is walking, whatever he does in his life, he remains aloof from all these material activities. Because his engagement in Krishna consciousness, no danger in the material world, no karmic reaction comes to his life. Prabhupada says, just like the snake, if you pull out the poisonous teeth of the snake, even though it looks like snake, it bites you, but there is no danger in your life. Similarly, the devotee who are engaged in the Krishna conscious activities, although they may appear to be living in the material world with a family and children and job and so many other sort of responsibilities, still the karma never touches the devotees, because they are conscious, their engagement totally only for the pleasure of Krishna consciousness, is nothing else. So in this way, material world, we have to understand, the moment you are a little bit deviating from the path laid out by the Prabhupada and the Acharyas, and it becomes the most dangerous place. Anytime the danger may come. Samasrita ye padapallava plava mahat padam punya yaso murari bhavam budir vatsa padam param 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 yatva padam natesam. At every moment in the material world, every step we make in the material world, there is a great danger awaiting for us. We don't even know the next moment we are going to be alive in this world, or we are going to die and go. Nobody bothers about our existence in the material world. As long as the soul is present in your body, there is some sort of interaction and reaction there in our life. The moment the soul leaves the body, you become a zero in the material world. Queen Kundi says, Kevayam Nama Rupavyam Yadubi Saha Pandava Bhavato Darshanam Yarsi Rishikenam Ivesito. Without you, my dear Lord, every living entity is our life, is like a zero, is nothing else. Because you're present in our heart, and because of your presence, the soul is also present in our heart. The moment you decide to leave this body, the soul, being your part and parcel, it also follows you. So without you, we are simply zero in the material world. The living entity in the material world, we come to this world as a zero. In between, we become little bit hero with material possession and name and fame and other pleasure. Finally, we die, we become a zero again. So Kunti Devi says, the life of the human being in the world is beginning zero, in between zero, finally zero again, nothing else. No. That's what Kunti says, Twahi me nanya visaya matir madupate sakrit rati mudva adat ala gange vagum mudanvati. My dear Lord, before you go off from this family of mine, please cut off whatever attachment I've got for my family, my kins, my relatives, and other people around. Please cut off all this attachment from here and let me focus into only your lotus feet and nothing else. Just like the Ganges river flowing into the ocean without any hindrance, let my attraction drown only unto your lotus feet, nothing else. Because you are the only swift deliverer of the living entities from this material world and nobody else. So the material world seems to be looking very nice here, but it's not that nice as what we look. It's looking very attractive, everything going on very well here. But the moment you interact, you go into a little bit of interaction for the self-enjoyment in the material world, and you'll begin to see the real nature of this material world. Everything somewhere or other is going on like a festival to attract the living entities to indulge their senses for their own personal interest, is nothing else. There was a man, he died, he was taken to the Yamaraj planet, and Yamaraj told him that, you know, you can visit two places and you decide which the place you want to go. I can take you to the Elish planet, I can take you to the heavenly planet, then you decide where you want to go and reside for a short time. So he was taken to the Elish planet, and Elish planet, he saw there was a big festival. When he went to the Elish planet, there was a lot of stages everywhere, there are a lot of flags is flying everywhere, and a lot of people singing and dancing, and a lot of talks are going on, and simply entertainment is nothing else. And people were given money, people were given rice, people were given intoxication, and there was wonderful atmosphere in the Elish planet. And Yamaraj says, now you have seen the Elish planet, let us go to the heavenly planet. And he was taken to the heavenly planet, and heavenly planet he saw is not as excited like Elish planet. Elish planet, so much excitement with everything going on there. Singing and dancing, to stage, to flex, to food giving, to everything. So heavenly planet little bit down compared to the Elish planet. So now Yamaraj asks him, now you decide where you want to go and reside. And he says, of course I want to go to the Elish planet because so much excitement there. So he was taken to the Elish planet, they left him in the Elish planet. But the moment they left him in the Elish planet, there is no more excitement there, there is no stage there, there is no flex there is no singing and dancing there is no giving out of rice or intoxication, anything. It was so dull in the Elish planet. So he asked the Yamaraj, you know, when I came before, it was so much excitement, so much of things were going on there. Now nothing is there. What is happening here? Yamaraj says, the time when we came, it was election time. You know? The politician has put up so much of stages everywhere. They have so much, you know, brought up all this entertainment for the people just to collect some votes from them. So now election is over. Now you go through the Elish condition of life. The material world, more relaxed, you know, everything is shown to us simply like an advertisement, is nothing else. Just like when we watch some movie, and the movie is very sorrowful, very depressing, and some people sitting and crying, and in between there's the advertisement of KFC, Kentucky Fried Chicken. Some little bit, you know, joyful advertisement. And after that you go back into the movie again. So material life means we are in the movie. And little bit of marriage life, family life, and making money to indulging in sense gratification is like a little bit of advertisement. Nothing else. So in this way, Krishna consciousness is so nice that it's been given to us. And if you be intelligent, you'll understand nothing else in the world is more sublime than Krishna consciousness been given to us. Even my mother, old lady, you know, she was initiated. She was, you know, on the death bed a few years ago. I went to see my mother 1 week before she left the body. And my mother called me and spoke to me. My mother says, of all the family members in the family here, of all the children, she said, you are the best. Because the moment he joined the Hare Krishna movement, till today he never brought any problem to me. Always he's been telling me, chant Hare Krishna and be happy, chant Hare Krishna and be happy, chant Hare Krishna and be happy. And all others, your brothers and sisters who have got married, entangled with so many things, every time they take a phone and call me, always telling about their problem. My mother says, I'm so happy about you because when you joined the Hare Krishna movement, you were very thin. I was only about 47 kilograms at that time. But after 3-4 years, you know, I came to 90 kilo. I was spending some time in New Zealand and Australia, so much of pure ghee, everything they know, even their food for life, khichdi to papadam to everything is fried by pure ghee. So I was baking like anything. My mother says, you went like this and you came back like that. That's the best thing has happened in your life. And my father always tells me, why not, you know, you chant Hare Krishna, but why not also you get married and have a wonderful life? Whenever my father sees me, he tells me, why not you marry and practice your Krishna consciousness? And I went to ask my mother, talk to my mother, mother, what do you think about this thing? Father's telling me all the time, I should get married and practice Krishna consciousness. My mother told me, you don't make that mistake. She told me that I made that mistake, my dear son. You do not make that mistake. She said, if I would have met Prabhupada before your father, I would have joined the Brahmacharini ashram. But that is life, what to do? We are still two living together as a family because we want to brought up this family. We got a great commitment towards this family and the children. So we are tolerating a few things, the difference between us. Otherwise, we have no business in the material world. So my mother, before she left the body, she told me one thing. She said, you know, whatever Prabhupada writes in his book is true. There is no false, you know, writing in Prabhupada books. She said, Prabhupada write one verse. She showed me one, you know, paragraph. Where Prabhupada says, when you become old and invalid in your life, you become like an unwanted guest in your own house. When you become old and invalid, and you become like an unwanted guest in your own house. My mother said, that is what I'm experiencing today. She told me, my dear son, this is the house all of you all have grown up. And that time I was young and you were all children. I had so much work to do in the house, and from morning to night, you know, I got so much work. Sometimes I get so much tired. I come to sleep in this room, and whenever I wanted to lie down for a little while, you children will come and jump on me, or mommy, 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 you want to play with us. Even I chase you away from you, none of you will go away from me. And today I'm the same mother in the old age, invalid, I'm lying down in this room. I'm calling so many of my children, even a dog is not coming to see me in my room. She said, what Prabhupada has written is very important for you to understand. Always stay in the Prabhupada movement. My life only changed. My life became so happy the moment I got Prabhupada books and his Krishna consciousness. And for this, I'm always very indebted to you. Carry on your life in a very happy way, in Krishna consciousness. Don't listen to anybody others, other than what Prabhupada has said. So this is the wonderful thing we have to understand. Our journey in the material world, our life in the material world, Prabhupada says, is the individual battle against Maya. You cannot sit here and complain so many things, and things are not going right the way you want. But there is the blessing of Krishna for you to understand the whole material world is not the right place for you to live. Mamupetyanta punarjanma dukalayam asasvatam. Because you got some plan, you're thinking everything is going to be right in the world, and your plan is going to bring you back to this material world again. So Krishna puts you in some difficulty for you to understand. Like Yudhishthira Maharaj asked, no, Krishna, we only know you, my dear Lord, nobody else, but why have we been put into these great difficulties? And Krishna says, yasyaham anugrahanami arisye taddhanam sane tato dhanam tyajati asya swajanam sukadukana. You are like a small child, my dear Yudhishthira, do not know what is the reality of this world. You are thinking, this is my family, this is my children, this is my friend, this is my country. You don't even know who's your friend and who's your enemy in the world. You are surrounded by all kinds of people, so I have to put you into certain way for you to understand who is your real friend in the material world. The moment you get into a different kind of difficulties, you understand all your so-called friends are running away from you. Maybe you do not know much about what is about all this friend and enemy. About 10 years ago, I went through the greatest difficulties in my life in the Krishna Conscious Movement. All the time I was collecting, I was building temple, I was doing so many things in my life. But 10 years ago, at the age of, 48 years old, I was diagnosed with cancer. That was the first time I'm going to the hospital, and the doctor said, you got to be admitted immediately. You have to undergo a surgery. Up to that point, I do not know anything about life, nothing. Always I'm in the environment of devotees, in the service of the Lord. The moment I was admitted in the hospital, I was alone sitting in the room. That was the time a lot of things came into my mind. At one point, the doctor told me, tomorrow afternoon, 2 o'clock is your surgery, you get ready. So morning you should be fasting. And the nurse will come and give you some information. And we are not very sure whether you will alive or you will go. But this thing has to be happened. So the next day morning, I was there. I was, being told by the doctor, 2 o'clock afternoon is my surgery. So I got to be get ready. But 6 o'clock in the morning, but I got up early that day, 4 o'clock in the morning in the hospital. I was taking my chanting beads. I thought, at least let me today chant some good rounds. All the time I was not serious about the chanting and other thing. At least today, maybe today is my last day. So I took up, I was there, was the best chanting I had in my life when I was in the hospital. So by Krishna's mercy, I learned a lot of things. That was the most greatest difficult time in my life. And morning 6 o'clock, the nurse came and told me, she said, the first operation is cancer. Now yours is the first one, get ready now. I was taken out, I was in the greatest anxiety. The moment she said, get ready now, we have to take you to the, surgery room. That was the time I, got exploited. I was crying. I do not know what to do. And I was sitting alone and crying. I was thinking about Prabhupada. Prabhupada says a human being, they should know two things very properly. They should know the art of living, and they also should know the art of dying. So I was thinking, at least a little bit I've learned of the art of living, but I did not learn the art of dying. Prabhupada, what to do? That was the best situation I was put in to understand that life is just, flickering, any moment it will go away from us. But somewhere or other, there was the education we learned. The Maya is very powerful, we do not know. After the surgery, then I was, told to go for radiation for 1 month. I have to go for the radiation, the hairs are false, drops, And I was there sitting alone in the radiation, rooms there. And there were a few others were sitting there, and there was a lady beside me sitting there. A young woman, she was, a little bit crying, and she spoke to me, I got this problem, cancer, I've come for radiation, and my useless husband, he has let me and gone, he thrown me and gone, I'm alone here. And she told me, maybe we should get together, maybe we should marry and, take care of each other. And I was thinking, Because so far in my life, no ladies have came and told me that I like you so much. So I didn't have any problem with any ladies. I didn't have any problem with any ladies because nobody has come to tell me you're looking very handsome, I'm attracted to you. So there was no thinking about anything, marriage or anything, nothing else in my life. And here I'm sitting in for the radiation. My hairs are dropping, you know, I lost about 25 kilo in 1 month. And this lady is telling, you know, we should join together, you know, we should help each other. And look at her, she's looking okay. But then I was thinking, I don't have money, I don't have, you know, home, I don't have job, I don't have anything. What I do marrying this lady? But there was the blessing of Krishna, he kept me beggar in the spiritual world. So I no need to divert anything else. In this way, I told her, whatever you propose is very nice, but I'm not in the position to take care of anybody because I need somebody to take care of me. So better you look for somebody who can take care of you. Thank you so much, you know. So life is a battle, we have to understand. There was a husband and wife and the mother. The man, his mother, and then his wife, they were going in the boat. They were going in the boat right in the river. So his wife, you know, jokingly asked him. She asked him, my dear husband, we are going in the boat in the river, and I do not know how to swim. Your mother do not know how to swim. Only you know how to swim. Let's say if the boat collapses, you know, and we all are going to drown, and I do not know how to swim. Your mother do not know how to swim. Only you know how to swim. So tell me whom you're going to save first, me or your mother? And he was put into that, you know, test, you know. If you're drowning, me and your mother drowning, whom you're going to save first? And immediately he says, I'm going to save my mother. And she got very upset about his answer. And she asked him, why are you going to save your mother first? And he said, because I only got one mother. Like you, I can find so many, why you worry? And she was very upset with him. She came back to the, you know, village. The next day she met one of her friends. She told her, you know, jokingly, I asked my husband, if the boat is drowned, if you're drowning, whom you will help first? And immediately the idiot, he says his mother. Because he says only got one mother, nobody else. So then he should marry his mother. Why you marry me? She told her friend, I'm cooking for him, I'm clothing, you know, washing clothes for him, taking care of the children, everything I do for him. But the moment of difficulty, he says he will help his mother first, not me. So I do not know what to do in my life. I do not know what to do. I do not know what to do. What is the solution? I do not know. And the friend says, why you worry? The solution is very simple, very easy. She says the solution is very simple and very easy. And a friend asked her, what is the solution? She said, you learn to swim. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Eka Krishna nama kahe sarva papa saya, navavida purna bhakti, eka nama hayam. Just by the chanting of the holy name, it will be clearing all kinds of difficulties and anxiety in our life. It's very simple and very easy to do. Prabhupada made it very easy for all of us, even though the Vedas are divided in so many ways. Even though we don't have that kind of intelligence to understand the scriptures. But still, Prabhupada made it in a very simple and very easy way that we also can participate in Krishna consciousness. And we also can cross over the cycle of repeated birth and death. Prabhupada made it in a very simple way, and Prabhupada don't want us to divert our attention to other things other than the movement of ISKCON and Krishna consciousness. The very ISKCON movement is established only for the purpose of helping the living entities to become Krishna conscious and cross over the cycle of repeated birth and death, is nothing else. That is what the reason Prabhupada don't want us to go to any other temples, any other organization besides ISKCON. He doesn't want to us to go and hear from so many other so-called Swamijis and Babajis. But whatever Prabhupada has given us, everything is already here for us to go back to the spiritual world. What is the requirement to go back to the spiritual world? It's already been given in the ISKCON movement and Prabhupada teaching. What is the requirement for us to go anywhere else unless you got some other intention of not going back to Godhead? If you want to go back to Godhead, this is the best place for you to sit and practice. The whole world we are traveling around, we are seeing, people are saying, this Krishna conscious movement looks like a fanaticism movement. Only Krishna, only Krishna, only Krishna. And Prabhupada says, Ante kale chama mevami, only Krishna conscious at the time of death, you will go back. And your Swamiji Prabhupada has made it so simple, but in the same time he made it like a very difficult for us because we have to follow certain rules and regulations. The whole world come to Hare Krishna thing, the whole world only know about ISKCON Prabhupada and no Babaji subject matter. You go to Australia, New Zealand, Switzerland, China, where we are traveling around, we are seeing none of any people, not even one person will understand all other Krishna conscious movement, Krishna's teaching, other than ISKCON and Prabhupada being the great movement. What is the requirement for us to go here and there? There is no requirement at all. Unless you are blind, you cannot see what is happening in this movement. Unless we are dumb, we are deaf, we do not even know what is happening around us. No. There was a father and son, they were living near the crematorium where they burned the body. No. So every time when they bring the dead body, the father will tell the son, follow the dead body and come back and tell me whether it's going to heaven or hell. So every time the son will follow the dead body and after cremation will come and tell the father, father, he is going to heaven. Or the some other time will say, father, he is going to hell. So the neighbor, there was man, you know, he was observing, he see all this thing all the time. And he was wondering how this boy know this man is going to heaven or hell. How he knows the dead body is going to heaven or hell? So he went and talked to him. I know you are a small boy, but you know, somewhere or other, I would like to know, how do you know that this dead body which been cremated is going to heaven or hell? And the boy says, very simple, well, you don't have eyes to see, you don't have ear to hear. You go stand there, you will know whether it's going to heaven or hell. And he asked him, how you know? He said, when you go there, everybody talking about this man. And when people are telling, lucky this guy is gone. When people are telling, lucky he's gone, that means he's going to hell. And people are saying, pity is gone, that means he's going to heaven, he's a good fellow. From the talk of the people, you'll understand. Somebody thinks he's a good man, he has gone soon, that means going to heaven. Somebody says a bad fellow, better for him to go, that means going to hell. From the talk of the town, you will understand whether he has gone to hell or heaven. From the talk of the world, you will understand what is ISKCON we are talking about, what is, you know, Krishna consciousness we are talking about. It's very simple and very easy subject matter, but it's an individual battle against Maya. And it's been given to us. We have to understand how to do it very nicely and properly in the association of the devotees of the Prabhupada movement. That's very important, very important. Prabhupada has created the wonderful atmosphere for us to come to Vrindavan. But living in Vrindavan, coming to Vrindavan is secondary things, unless your consciousness is more Vrindavan and nothing else. If your consciousness is Krishna consciousness, your Vrindavan consciousness, and you are really living in the Vrindavan, but if you're hanging around in the Loi Bazaar, if you're hanging around in the Govinda restaurant, you're hanging around with your friends and your relatives talking about all kinds of things other than Vrindavan subject matter, then you're not living in Vrindavan. There are monkeys are living in Vrindavan, there are dogs are living in Vrindavan, there are pigs are living in Vrindavan. No. But what we are living in Vrindavan, unless we become Krishna conscious, is nothing else. So consciousness of the living entities become much more powerful than anything else in the material world. So Prabhupada has created this thing for us so that, you know, we can pass over, we can, you know, cross over this cycle of repeated birth and death. Very practical, very easy manner. and nothing else for us to complain about. Because the whole material life is very challenging. There are so much of tests and tribulation are there in our life. Nothing is going to be easy in the material world as long as we are staying here, as long as there is interaction in the material world. And it's going to be a great, great danger and diversion to other things. And the moment we are diverted to so many other things and the question of going back to Krishna, it becomes very challenging. It's not easy for us to do this thing. But somewhere or other, our habit is so bad. It's not Prabhupada's fault, it's not ISKCON's fault, it's not Krishna consciousness' fault. When we face some problem, it's only we have got so much of, you know, anartha in ourselves. Naturally, you know, we are carried away by kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madam, matsarya. The moment we come into the material world and connected to the materialistic way of life, there are so much of personal desires are coming into our life. Nothing else, so the habit is not changing. So we are seeing the problem inside us, though like the problem is, you know, from outside, but actually is a problem of kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madam, matsarya. Are within us, nothing else. There was a man, he was in the textile business. He was very successful at one time, but after some time, you know, he became bankrupt. He lost everything. So he, you know, became a little bit poor. And he was in the house, you know, always with the children, you know, the children have grown up. All the time they're talking, you know. All the time when he talked to his children, he would talk about how he was succeeded in business at one time and how he lost everything in his life. So all the time he was talking about his problem, his depression, his distress of life, how he became failure. So every time he talks to anybody, he only talk about the failure he has gone through in his life. He was very sorrow, very distressed all the time. So the children do not know what to do with the father. The things happened so long ago, and you are now, we are grown up, we can take care of you, why worry about those things? But the father is not letting it go, all the old story of him. So at that time, there was a Swamiji came to the place, you know, the village, you know, to speak, you know, Ramayana for 48 days. So then the children went and saw the Swamiji. They said, my father has got this problem. Always, you know, he is talking about his old story, not coming to the new story. So please help him. The Swamiji said, don't worry, I'm going to speak 48 days, I'm going to speak Ramayana in this village. Send your father, I'll talk 48 days, I'll talk Ramayana. Sure your father will change. So after 48 days, after hearing the Ramayana, the children came to take the father. And they took the father, they went to meet the Swamiji. And the Swamiji asked the old man, so you are happy now after hearing 48 days of Ramayana? Now you have changed your mind and you are very happy now? And the man says, my dear Swamiji, whatever you said is very wonderful things. I was so happy to hear whatever you said, you know, the Ram, the Dharma and everything. But only problem is that, why did not you come 20 years ago? You know, Swamiji, I was in the textile business, I lost everything. He started to tell the whole story to the Swamiji. And the Swamiji, the children were very upset. After 48 days of Ramayana, the father not changed. And Swamiji said, don't worry, don't worry. I'm going to another village to speak Mahabharatam for 48 days. Send your father. So they sent the father, you know, to hear the Mahabharatam for 48 days. And after 48 days, the children came to take back the father. Then they went to meet the Swamiji. And the Swamiji asked the old man, so you're happy now after hearing the Mahabharatam? And the man says, Swamiji, your Mahabharatam is better than Ramayana. So wonderful, so wonderful. Who's demon, who's devotee, all I've understood from there. But only problem, Swamiji, why not you come, you know, 20 years ago? Do you know, Swamiji, I was in a great textile business and I've lost everything. The father not changed. And they were looking at the Swamiji. Swamiji said, don't worry, don't worry. There is always some way to go. Then he took them, he said, come, let us go to the crematorium where they are burning all the dead body. So the Swamiji and the old man, the children, you know, they all went to the crematorium. And there, you know, so much of dead body has been being burned there. So much of wood they are using, they are burning the dead body. And the Swamiji looked at the old man, he looked at him, look at that! You are simply crying for your textile business. Look at that. People have lost their own body, have lost everything. Even their own body is being burned. What to talk about your textile business? Understand, understand. And the old man looking at that place, you know, always there are one after another body, you know, one body after another, one dead body finished, another dead body coming in. And they were using so much of wood to burn the dead body. At that moment, the old man, he bowed down and touched the feet of Swamiji. He says, "My dear Swamiji, I've understood what is your message. I've understood what is your message. I've understood, Swamiji. Why not you come and tell me 20 years ago of this important message? 20 years ago you should have told me what to do in my life." Swamiji said, "What is that?" And the old man says, I was in the wrong business all the time, Swamiji. I was in the textile business, but looking at the dead body being burned with so much of wood, instead of textile business, I would have started the wood business." So sometimes our bad habit, the mind flickering like a prostitute, is not anything to do with the ISKCON movement or Prabhupada teaching. If you understand, if you have got a great faith, just like the cobbler, he met Narada Muni, just like the Brahmin, he met Narada Muni. Both of them, they asked Narada Muni, "If you are going to Vishnu Lok, try to ask Vishnu when our time of going back to the Vaikuntha." And Narada Muni talked to Vishnu about this thing. There's a Brahmin wants to know when he's going to come back to Vaikuntha. There is a cobbler, he wants to know when he's going to come back. And Krishna says, Vaikuntha, Lord Vishnu says, the cobbler will come first. It will take many time, lifetime for the Brahmin to come. And you'll understand, go and talk to them. But when you go and see them, you tell them, they'll ask you what I'm doing. You tell them that I'm trading, I'm putting an elephant into the needle, eye of the needle. So he came back and then he met the Brahmana. And Brahmana asked him, "So what Vishnu been doing when you went there?" He said, "I saw Vishnu been, he putting the elephant into the eye of the needle. He pushing through the elephant into the needle hole." And Brahmana says, "Don't give that kind of jokes to me. How is possible for the elephant to go into the eyes of the needle? It's not possible." Then Narada Muni understood, he's a very great learned person, but he has no faith in the Supreme Lord. Then he went to the cobbler, and cobbler asked him what the Vishnu is doing. He says he's putting the elephant through the eye of the needle. And the cobbler, he was jumping and laughing, and he was so happy. So wonderful pastime of the Lord. What is so difficult for the Lord to put the elephant through the eye of the needle? Just like I'm sitting under this banyan tree, there are so many fruits are falling, so many seeds are there. Within the seed, there is another banyan tree. The whole big banyan tree can be in the small seed. What is so difficult for an elephant to go into the eye of the needle? So the Bhagavatam Prabhupada books are like a great banyan tree. There's a seed is given to us, the banyan is already inside us. But if you got a great faith in the path of Krishna consciousness on this movement, Prabhupada will bless your life. Very simple. My mother was not very educated. She don't even know how to read and write. My mother had some difficulty in her life with my father. My father was very, very loving for all the children. But somewhere or other, that, chemistry between my father and my mother didn't work out that well. So my mother, most of the time, she would be sitting and crying. So when I became a devotee, I went and spoke to my mother, asked my mother, "Do you really want to become happy in your life?" My mother said, "Yes." And I told my mother, "You take the Bhagavad Gita and read the Bhagavad Gita. And when you're tired of reading, I give you the beats, you chant Hare Krishna, and you will see no way, nobody can come and make problem into your life." My mother told me, "I do not know how to read." I said, "You take the book and look at the book, Krishna will help you." You know, my mother started to read, she can start reading, my mother can read the Bhagavad Gita. Before that, she do not know how to read. Just every day she will keep the Bhagavad Gita. She look at the Bhagavad Gita. And when she is tired, she keep the Bhagavad Gita on her lap. And she, take the chanting beats. And she will be chanting and chanting and chanting. So at that moment, my father will come around to start the communication with my mother. The communication is the beginning point of misunderstanding and fight. So I told my mother, at any moment anybody comes, even father comes, Don't put away your chanting beads and don't put away your Bhagavad Gita. Always keep the Bhagavad Gita with you and chanting beads in your hand. You will see how it will work, you know, positively in your life. So my father will come around and come around to talk to my mother. You know, because my father wants to create some, you know, some fight with my mother, but somewhere or other, either she is chanting or she is with the Bhagavad Gita. And my father also very religious person. He knows, you know, the Bhagavad Gita is a holy book and the beats is a holy beats and we should not disturb anybody, you know, with the Bhagavad Gita or chanting. And my father will go around and go around and go around waiting for the right time to talk to my mother. But somewhere the 24 hours, either my mother with the chanting beats or Bhagavad Gita. And there was no problem at all between my father and my mother after that. And one day, you know, my father came and told me, you know, my dear son, I don't mind you become Hare Krishna, sannyasi or brahmachari, but, you know, I'm very unhappy. You make your mother, you know, devotee. She's not even talking to me. And we are not even having any fight in our life. So my mother told me, very wonderful thing happens in my life. The chanting beads and Prabhupada books have solved all the problem in my life. So keep yourself very healthy way in Krishna consciousness. It's an individual battle against Maya. But Prabhupada and the devotees, the environment in ISKCON movement totally really will help you. But little bit of difficulty is like an advertisement in our life. But the real picture is that, you know, we are trying to become devotee. We are trying to sincerely to approach lotus feet of the Lord. And surely Krishna will bless our life. Surely Prabhupada will bless our life. You stay in the ISKCON movement, read Prabhupada books, and always, always, you know, understand it's an individual battle against Maya. It's nothing else. And take the, you know, a great opportunity and, you know, practice Krishna consciousness. Surely within this very lifetime, you'll go back to Godhead. Durvasa Muni was blessed with so much of, you know, Durvasa Muni was blessed with so much of, you know, siddhis. He got Anima Siddhi, he got Mahima Siddhi, he got Garima Siddhi, Lagima Siddhi, Prapti, Prakampya, Isidva, Vasidva. He can do so many things with his life. Durvasa Muni, he can do so many things. He can go smaller than smaller, he can go bigger than bigger, he can go heavier than heavier, he can go lighter than lighter, he can sit here, he can travel all around the world, he can sit here, he can bring anything from anywhere, he can sit here, he can control people's mind, he can manipulate every material element. He got all the, you know, siddhis in his life. Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Sakala Asanta Krishna Bhakta Kevala Santa Kinonathin in his come. Even he had got all the material advancement, but he was not happy. He's very restless in his life. Whereas Durvasa Muni, he was so peaceful and very happy. So what is the point of having all this siddhi, but you know, you don't even know how to protect your life. You got all the siddhi. Now he's running to different places for protection. He's not able to protect his own life with all this siddhi. There was a time in Vrindavan, there was a magician came to show some, you know, of his magical, you know, magical tricks to the Gurukul boys, and he came and saw Prabhupada. And he told Prabhupada, I can do all these magical things, you know, I can, you know, make these things to disappear, that things to disappear. And Prabhupada asked him, you know, I want to ask you one question. Can you make disappear the birth, old age, death and disease? Can you make it disappear? You can make disappear the money, you can just make disappear the clothes, you can make disappear the aeroplane. But I want to ask you one thing, can you make disappear the birth, old age, disease and death? And the magician says, I cannot do that, Swamiji. Prabhupada says, I can do that. Jara marana mokshayamam asritya yatantite te brahma tadvidam krishnam Adiyatmam karmanishchalam. And Prabhupada's power, devotees' power, much more greater than all the so-called yogis and siddhis. Sorry for taking a little bit extra time. And be happy in Vrindavan. Always come for the Mangala Arati. The basic thing, always come for the Bhagavadam. There are some devotees are not able to come. They watch the Mangala Arati in their TV, in their house. There somebody is not able to come, they are turned on the radio and then they hear the Bhagavadam. But the better, best of everything, if you can come, please come and directly participate. Don't rely on the television, don't rely on the, you know, radio. When there is no electricity goes around and then you are not able to hear. The important one of the Alwar, he says that, is from South India. He said, Tuppudaiyarai adivadallam sorvidattu tunaipurivarendru opinalam ninnai adendhen anaikkini arulcheidhamayal. ஏய்ப்பு வந்து என்னை நெளியும் பொழுது ஏதங்கு நான் உன்னை நினைக்க மாட்டேன். அப்போதைக்கு இப்போதை சொல்லி வைத்தேன் அலங்காதரவனை பள்ளியனே. இஸ் இ வெரி ஒண்டர்ஃபுல்லி சேஸ் மை டியர் லார்ட், பீப்புள் இன் திஸ் மெட்டீரியல் வேர்ல்ட் தி ஆர் லுக்கிங் ஃபார் சம் பார்ட்னர், தி ஆர் லுக்கிங் டு கெட் மேரிட். ஈவன் தோ தே நோ மேரிட் லைஃப் இஸ் ஸோ டிஃபிகல்ட், இட்ஸ் நாட் ஈஸி. ஈவன் மேரேஜ் லைஃப் இஸ் ஸோ டிஃபிகல்ட், இட்ஸ் நாட் ஈஸி. பட் ஸ்டில் த பேரண்ட்ஸ் are pushing the children towards, you know, for the children to get married. Even they know the married life is so much of challenging there. Why? Because they know in time to come, when you're old, who is going to look after you? When you become old and invalid, you know, you need a wife or you need a husband who can help each other, take care of yourself. The Alwar says, my dear Lord, I don't believe in this narration. I don't believe the husband will take care, the wife will take care. But I believe that you will take care. Why? Because even the Gajendra elephant called you, you came to help him. Even the elephant called, you have come. I'm a devotee, I call one, you won't come. So I only depend on you. And beautifully he says, my dear Lord, the time will come, I won't be able to come to your temple. The time will come, I won't be able to sit in the association of a devotees to hear your glories. The time will come, I won't be able to come and see your beauty in the temple. The time will come, I'll become invalid, I'll become old, and I'll be bedridden in my life. I won't be able to come. So before that time come, my dear Lord, let me go to your temple. Let me go and sit in the association of the devotees and hear the Bhagavatam. Let me do everything in the association of devotees. When the time comes, I cannot do. I become invalid. Let me turn on the television and see your Mangala Arati. Turn on radio and hear the glorification of Bhagavata. The time will come. We cannot do anything. We cannot come to the temple. Cannot be associated with the devotees. That time, we can do everything in our own environment. But when we are given the great opportunity in the association of devotees, let us take the opportunity, be in the association of devotees. Satam prasangam mama mirya sammido. When in the association of devotees, you hear and chant the holy name of the Lord, apavargasya, you go, progress more and more and more in your life. Thank you so much for being here. Looking forward for the Kartik and Damodara festival. Jai Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Nitai Gora Pramanande.